And we're going to begin immediately with the second conference of the day. Dr. David Weinstein, current treatment, how to estimate cornstarch dosage, and everything included in your program. So let's receive the Dr. Weinstein with a big applause.
While we're getting the slides up, if people want to stand up for 1 minute and stretch, just to, well. Are we doing this without slides? Okay, perfect. So, well, thank you, we'll begin. So again, I want to thank everybody for being here. This is a disease that very few doctors know about, and we've already just massively increased the knowledge of glycogen storage disease in this country. And again, thank you for your interest in this. The goal is to work together. So let me first make sure that you have my new contact information. So as of 2 weeks from now, we'll be moving from Florida to the University of Connecticut it's Hartford, Connecticut, and the name of the hospital is Connecticut Children's. And I want people to reach out to me. I don't have my new contact information yet, but please, if I could be of any assistance, email me, call me. And if there are any students who are ever interested in doing work on this disease or getting exposure, you're welcome to come to our unit. So I look forward to working with people. I'd just like to give you the disclosures. I work with several companies, but everything that I do is unpaid. So VitaFlow and Nestle make the glycoside. I'm working on gene therapy and alternative treatments, but none of the work that I will discuss had any influence by industry or by companies. There's no money involved. So as you've heard several times today, glycogen storage disease is very common in Mexico. Worldwide, it's 1 in 100,000. The estimate you heard from Dr. Cohen is 1 in 20,000 here in Mexico, and it may be even higher. You've heard this already, so I hope this gets people's attention, that there are lots of children with glycogen storage disease here. Now, if you look at Mexico, it is unique. I have visited patients with GSD in 62 countries, and I've never seen a country with three distinct populations of GSD like we have here in Mexico. In Mexico, in the north, in Monterrey and some of the northern areas, you have mostly GSD 1A. Monterrey, Mexico has a mutation that is pretty much specific for that area. And Monterrey appears to have more GSD than any city in the world. There's also a second mutation here in Mexico that we can trace back to Spain, to one area in Spain, Galicia, Spain, and the people from Galicia and the people in Mexico share a mutation, and we have records connecting them. Gracias. There's also GSD type 3, and most of the type 3 glycogen storage diseases along the Pacific coast of Mexico. What's very interesting is if you go along the Pacific coast, all the way down to Chile, you see GSD 3. And so for those doctors who see the patients from that area, it's something to think about. There's also a variant of GSD type 9 that is specific for the Mayan population. And so we have seen it in several children down south and people who have Mayan heritage. So it's worth knowing about this disease. And again, I hope that we'll be able to foster relationships. You saw this slide, so I won't go through it again, but our goal is to normalize all the glucose and all the metabolites. The mutation that's seen here in Mexico is also unique because it's a little milder than the other mutations. The mutation from Monterrey has partial enzyme activity. And what that means is that instead of having a complete block with glucose-6-phosphate to glucose, about 3 to 5% of glycogen can break down and form glucose. That helps to maintain the blood sugars. It helps to keep the children alive. But 95% of the glycogen is breaking down to form uric acid, lactate, and the triglycerides. And if we're going to keep people healthy, we have to normalize all of those. And so it's important, if you're taking care of people from Monterey, that you normalize all the labs and not just the glucose. The mutation that is seen in Monterey and in the northern part is this one. And it's a very specific mutation. It's only been seen in people of Mexican heritage. And it's something that should make genetic testing easy, because almost all GSD1A has two mutations in this country. So if we could set up testing using testing for this mutation and testing for potentially even the other one, the one that came from Spain, we could probably do testing for under 200 pesos. We've been able to do this in other countries where if we know the mutation, we can get a quick screen. And this is the what happens is you get the 130X mutation. So I already went through this, so we can just move ahead in terms of the significance. Now, glycogen storage disease was a devastating disease until 1971. The treatment, and the only treatment up until that point, was a portocaval shunt. What doctors would do is do radical surgery on children with glycogen storage disease, and they would bypass the hepatic portal vein into the vena cava. The theory was that by keeping the sugar away from the liver, it would maintain the blood sugars in the systemic population. And the goal was not to have the liver take up the glycogen. Now, you could imagine if you took critically ill children and you tried to do the surgery, it didn't go very well. And over half the children died during the surgery. Almost everybody else had complications, and the children were not doing well. In November 1971, my mentor, Dr. John Kriegler, many of you may know him from Kriegler-Najjar syndrome, Dr. Kriegler admitted this child to Boston Children's. And he felt that the child was too sick to have the surgery. And he had a hypothesis. And his hypothesis was that if you gave enough glucose, that not only would you maintain the blood sugars, but you would stop glycogen breakdown and normalize the lactate and the triglycerides. That sounds so basic right now, but that was not appreciated in 1971. So Dr. Kriegler admitted this child, put the child on IV nutrition, which had just been introduced. And when he did that, all of the child's metabolic problems disappeared. So you can see here the discoloration of the skin. That's from triglycerides that were over 25,000 at the time. Normal's under 200. And when he started the IV nutrition, they normalized. The lactic acid in this child was over 25 millimoles per liter. And again, with normal's under 2, and it normalized. And that led to the first treatment for glycogen storage disease. Now there's a very important part of that story. When portocaval shunts were used, patients were told to eat as much carbohydrate as possible. So patients were told to eat pasta, rice, bread, because the goal was to maintain the blood sugar in the circulation. And for many years, that diet kept getting passed on, and we'll talk about how it's changed, but that's where it came from. After Dr. Kriegler made that discovery, children were treated with continuous feeds. So in the 1970s, people had nasogastric tubes, and they'd be fed 24 hours a day with continuous feeds, or a lot of them started getting G-tubes, gastrostomy tubes. That allowed people to start to survive, but there was a problem. First, being connected to a tube is very difficult all the time. Secondly, any interruption in that feed would be devastating. And because there was no reserve, and because it was a high insulin state, any interruption in that feed could result in seizures or even death. The average child had about 3 seizures a year when treated this way. And if a pump stopped or there was a leak overnight, the child would just die. And to this day, this is why we don't like continuous feeds and we prefer the next treatment, which came along in 1982, which is Mazena or cornstarch. Now, Dr. Cohen introduced cornstarch to you. In the 1970s, almost every carbohydrate that you could imagine was tested. Rice, potato, even alcohol infusions were done in children. And cornstarch was found to be the best. What is unique about cornstarch is that it breaks down at the same rate, approximately, that the body uses it, so that it doesn't get stored in the liver and it provides energy. If you use an energy source that's too fast, the sugars go up and it stores in the liver. It also spikes the insulin. If you use something that's too slow, the hypoglycemia occurs. And cornstarch had the unique properties of matching the needs, and that's where it came from. Well, by the 1990s, problems started to occur. So a very dear friend of mine, Peter Smith, wrote an article in 1990 warning that complications started to be seen in GSD. Short stature, liver adenomas, and even cancer were developing in the type 1 patients, and heart disease and muscle disease in type 3. One of the mistakes that happened in this field was that the complications were blamed on the Mazena, on the cornstarch. It had nothing to do with that. Complications were occurring simply because people were getting older. And it wasn't due to the treatment, it was that people didn't live long enough to have complications before this. So in many places in the world, cornstarch got a bad name. And I want to emphasize that it wasn't the cornstarch that caused these problems. By 1994, they did the first large survey of people with GSD. And what you can see from this article is that almost everybody was developing problems. Liver adenomas were occurring in almost all teenagers. And in 2002, I'll show you, kidney disease was occurring in everybody. I mentioned earlier in my introduction that 1998 was when I decided to do this disease. This is a child who I met in 1998. You can see the massive liver. The children weren't doing well. And as I said previously, there was very little hope for the children with GSD. Well, I was a pediatric endocrinologist. And some of you may remember the changes that occurred in the 1990s in diabetes. When I trained as a diabetes doctor, almost everybody was developing complications. The insulins that were used when I was a student were beef and pork insulin, and people couldn't get good control. In 1994, there was a landmark diabetes study, a diabetes control and complications trial, that showed that with good metabolic control, the complications could be prevented. Human insulin had come along in about 1989, and we were getting better control, and then the complications started to disappear. So I saw this happening in diabetes, and I questioned, when I started to do GSDs, could we do the same thing in GSD? The average triglycerides were 1,280 in the United States, or 14.5 millimoles per liter. And my mentors, who are great people, were telling me, well, you can't do any better. Abnormal labs are just part of the disease. But instead of accepting that, we started to question, what can we do to improve metabolic control? So 3 major changes have happened, and we're going to work through these. The first one was changing the way cornstarch was administered. The second thing we did was start paying attention to the diet and restricting the intake of sugars and fruit. And the third change had to do with that large carbohydrate load that people were being told to give that dated back to the 1970s. And we started to question whether that was the right treatment. So let's talk about cornstarch dosing. When cornstarch was introduced, it was introduced as 1.75 grams per kilo every 6 hours. Now that treatment was revolutionary. It allowed people with GSD to survive, but it wasn't achieving good control. The other problem that occurred was that all the studies when that dosing was done were done on young children. And so it wasn't clear if this dosing was correct. So this is from one of the studies, and it showed where the number came from. When people were young, it looked like there was a linear relationship. And if you keep going up with age, people are going to get very high doses. But in 1984, two doctors, Denny Beer and Maury Heyman, did a study using radioisotopes to look at glucose requirements. And what they found is that glucose requirements don't continue to go up with weight. They don't continue to go up with age. They actually stabilize. And a 7 or 8 year old child has the same glucose requirement as an adult. And that's because the biggest utilizer of glucose in the body is the brain. The brain grows until about 8 years of age, and then it stops growing. And when the brain stops growing, the glucose requirements stop going up. And if people continue to dose cornstarch based upon weight, their doses are going to continue to go up in adulthood, and we end up over-treating patients. So one take home is that if you're dosing cornstarch by weight after 8, you're over-treated. Over-treatment will cause extra weight to occur, which is why people used to be extremely fat with glycogen storage disease. It will cause excessive insulin to be made, and when the body makes insulin, you get rebound hypoglycemia. And as a take-home message, the highest doses that we really ever use in any of my patients, and these are really only used at night, would be 65 or very rarely 70 grams of cornstarch. If you're over that, you're almost certainly over-treated. The second change we did was to look at the laboratory values. And what we found is that we couldn't get good laboratory values on the every 6 hour dosing. When we started doing smaller doses more frequently, with doses every 3 to 4 hours in children and every 3 to 5 hours in adults, we found that we got much better control. That during the 4th, 5th, 6th hour, the blood sugars were dropping and lactic acid would go up and triglycerides would increase. By giving smaller doses more frequently, we can normalize the glucose and the laboratory studies. Then what we do is we ask people to check their sugars at home, or we bring them into the hospital once a year, and we adjust their doses to normalize the glucose and the lactate concentrations. The next big change we did was to get strict with the diet. When people were very poorly controlled, it wasn't apparent that the diet made a big difference. But once people started getting better numbers, it could be seen that whenever people ate fruit or dairy, their lactic acid and their triglycerides would go up. And why does this occur? Dr. Cohen had introduced this, but fruit sugar enters the liver. And when people have, say, orange juice, it quickly gets converted from fructose to fructose-6-phosphate to glucose-6-phosphate back to glucose. All fruit sugar goes into the liver. And if people eat fruit, it's going to get stored as glycogen, or it's going to lead to a buildup of lactate and triglycerides and uric acid. So just to give you an example, not all my patients listen to me. So I have a 43-year-old lady who grew up when there were no dietary restrictions, and she still likes juice. When she came into our hospital, she wanted some orange juice, but our kitchen, we have a special metabolic kitchen, wouldn't give her any orange juice. So she had breakfast and then told us she was going for a walk and went down to our cafeteria to get some orange juice. Now, she didn't tell us she was doing that, but when she came back to the floor, her glucose hadn't changed because fruit sugar can't form glucose. So her blood sugars before were in the 80s and they were still in the 80s. But in 1 hour, her lactic acid had gone from 1.8 to over 8 millimoles per liter just from having juice. So it shows what happens when people consume juice, and the same thing happens if you have a lot of dairy sugar or any sugar. So we limit people to a total of 2.5 grams of non-utilizable sugar. which is fruit sugar plus half of dairy sugar, because lactose is half galactose and half glucose, and sucrose combined. The next change we did had to do with how people were, the diet that people were being told to eat. So I think anybody who's dealt with GSD who's older remembers old-time GSD. People were short, people were fat, kind of like me, except I hope I'm not that bad. But this is what GSD used to be. Everybody was very large. They looked like Americans. But I started thinking about it. You would never know it now, but I used to run marathons. And the day before the marathon race, they tell people to eat a lot of pasta and carbohydrates to load up your liver with glycogen. And I remember sitting down and watching my patients eat the same meal that I would eat before I ran a marathon. And I started thinking that this is crazy. We're telling people to eat a diet that is loading their liver up with glycogen. Maybe the diet that's been people have been using since the 1970s is incorrect, and we should start backing off on carbohydrate to avoid storage in the liver. So we started to do that, and we taught patients to carbohydrate count, and we limit meals to 15 or 20 grams of carbohydrate. And what we found was dramatic. Within 1 year, people became skinny because we weren't overloading the liver. So this is 1 year between these pictures. I don't have a before picture, but you can see the days of the fat, short people with GSD are gone. People are slim, they're doing great, and remind me someone at the end, I have to ask Dr. Cohen if I take cornstarch, if that's gonna help me thin out, because I was impressed with his pictures also. So the goal of treatment in GSD is to maintain normal glucose concentrations, and we say above 75 milligrams per deciliter. We want to avoid high sugar, so we keep it under 100 because we don't want high levels which will store in the liver and increase the insulin. And then we aim for normal lactic acid levels. When we accomplish this, every laboratory study in a person with GSD1A normalizes. So my expectation is that people will have normal AST, ALTs, normal triglycerides, normal lactic acid, and normal uric acid. If we're not achieving this, that means the treatment's off, either the diet or we're not covering periods well, we're overtreated or we're undertreated, and the treatment needs to be adjusted. It's very rare nowadays where we even need to use medications, and medications are not the answer. If we see labs that are off, the answer is fix what's wrong with the control. People with GSD today are healthy. So these are people with GSD1A. I don't think anybody would know that these patients have glycogen storage disease. By the way, the story that I told at the beginning about the mother with the 14-month-old boys, these are those boys now. And they're American football players, they did great. You can see people, this lady was one of my first patients, and this picture is when she ran a triathlon. And it was 4 months after she gave birth to her first child. I was impressed. I can't imagine running a triathlon, and she did it with GSD1A. This gentleman is an outstanding tennis player. This is Iris's son, who is a lacrosse player. And even though Americans are not very good at football, to play 90 minutes of football with GSD is still quite an accomplishment. So I want people to stay awake, so I'm going to ask for some participation here. This is from the World Championships of Baseball. And one of the people here with glycogen, one of the people in this picture has glycogen storage disease. Would you like to take a guess? Anybody want to take a guess of? Okay, this guy? Okay, so the most common answer is this guy. That's when I ask the kids, that's always the answer. But the short, fat person is just the American coach who went over to Israel to coach. The other common one is this guy because he looks young, but the person with GSD is this gentleman. I don't think anybody would know that he has glycogen storage disease, and he was the most valuable player on the team. I just want to emphasize that people with GSD are not sick people now, and we shouldn't tolerate any limitations. We should aim for perfection. I'm proud to say that five of my patients have become doctors in the last 2 years. They're all doctors who are practicing, and now they're all going to be doing helping to manage GSD. So you met Dr. Cohen. This lady, by the way, is not a doctor. She's an engineer. She's here in Mexico, and she'll be at the meeting tomorrow. This is Dr. Monica, who's from Poland. When I met her, she was going into liver and kidney failure. Now, 14 years later, she's healthy, she works for a program, and she's going to be working on the gene therapy. And this is Dr. Nerea, who's working with Glucolatino. She's a doctor in Spain helping to take care of the people there. Well, with the improved control, we ended up showing that all complications in GSD are now preventable. So Damien, Dr. Cohen introduced this, but articles have come out over the last 5 years showing that every one of these complications can be avoided if we strive for good labs and good control. So let me work through some of these with you. The first thing is growth. Again, the growth problems were all due to the lactic acid. When people were acidotic, they didn't grow. So this is a boy that was sent to me. His triglycerides were very high, his lactate was very high, and he is standing next to his brother, who is 4 years younger than him, but they're about the same size. We put him on cornstarch, normalized his labs, and you can see now the boy with GSD is tall, he's thin, and actually the one without GSD is the one that looks like he has GSD. He's the short, fat one. Liver adenomas were the biggest problem that I used to deal with. We used to frequently do surgery on people with glycogen storage disease 1A in 2000, 2001, the first 5 years of 2000 to 2005, because most of the patients were ending up with liver tumors, with adenomas. They would appear during puberty, they're hormonally sensitive, and they would grow. And frequently they would stop after puberty, but if they continue to grow, we would have to take them out. The first evidence that it was that these adenomas could be prevented. Oh, somehow a slide got out of order. The first evidence came in 2002. And we did a retrospective look at the people who were developing adenomas. And what we found is that people who had adenomas ran higher lactates than people who did not get adenomas. We also found that the peak lactate was much higher. Now, that was criticized because it's retrospective and people don't like small numbers. And so we put together a study looking to see if good control can make a difference in a prospective way. What we did is we designed a study using 500 milligrams per deciliter as the cutoff. Now, that number came from a committee meeting where doctors were asked, what is good control in GSD? At that committee meeting, we had people who were saying 1,000 for the triglycerides was good. We were pushing for 200, and we fought all day long trying to pick a number. And in the end, just to get out of the room, we settled on 500. Personally, that was too high for me, but that was what the guidelines said when they were first introduced. So what we did is we looked at people who had triglycerides over 500 and people who had triglycerides under 500. And what you can see here, when someone developed an adenoma that would go down, this is the percent of adenoma-free patients, and there's a dramatic decrease in adenoma formation when people had good control compared to the people who had high triglycerides and lactate. We did a sub-analysis. This was predefined, but we did a sub-analysis. And nobody in 20 years has developed adenomas in their liver if they've kept their triglycerides under 380 as a mean. The person who did this study was David Wang, who was a student from me. He did another analysis. He did a case control series where he took people who developed adenomas, and then when they've developed an adenoma, he would find a gender-matched, age-matched person who didn't have it to compare that person to. And in the case control studies, you got very, very similar numbers. The people who had adenomas had an average triglycerides of 700 and approximately 740. And the people who did not have adenomas had much lower triglycerides. So I think there's increased evidence that metabolic control is related to the adenoma formation and can help prevent it. Now the question came to us, what about the people who have adenomas? Does metabolic control help them at all? So we did a study with a doctor by the name of Richard Beagle. Richard Beagle's a radiologist. And he would look at these images when the people would come in. So we asked him independently to do a study with us. And what we did is we took people with adenomas and we assessed over time what would happen to them if they got good control. And what Richard reported was that he had 9 patients of the 13 that had been referred to with adenomas, 9 people with recurrent MRIs. Of those people, 6 of the 9 had complete regression of their adenomas once people got good control. I didn't think this was possible. You know, there was one report in the 80s about this happening. I thought it was just an artifact of ultrasound. You know, it was a technician who had missed it. But these were on MRIs. And what was amazing is you could follow the MRIs year after year after year, seeing them shrink until the adenomas disappeared. So it took an average of 4.8 years for the adenomas to disappear. It didn't happen overnight. But the adenomas would disappear. What about the people who had, those 3 people I said who didn't have complete regression? Well, the adenomas have shrunk in all of those people. One of those patients was sent to me with an adenoma that was approximately 16 centimeters. Normally we would have done a liver transplant, but she was so sick that the transplant doctors didn't want to go near her, so we decided to fix her control. They haven't completely disappeared her adenomas, but her adenoma is now about 5 centimeters. She's also had 2 children since then and never needed the surgery and is doing very, very well. And they continue to shrink at every visit. So I think when we see people with adenomas, the first thing we should do is work on improving metabolic control. What about kidney disease? There was a slide there that was out of order, but what it showed was that in 2002, Peter Smith published the data from the European study for glycogen storage disease. And at that time, 100% of people with GSD1A had kidney disease by the time they turned 24. When he surveyed the adult population, 28% of the patients with GSD needed dialysis. That is not good enough. So the kidney disease that occurs resembles diabetic nephropathy for those people who have seen it. As I said, used to occur all the time, and now we have evidence to show it's the complication most tightly correlated with metabolic control. Oh, so here's the slide from Peter. We have recently looked at the adults in our population. And this was done by Todd Cheng Supanamit, who is a medical student. And what we looked at people who were 20 to 30 years of age, where previously they would have 100% rate of protein in the urine, it's now down to 6%. Even the people who did have the benefits of good control, who are over 30, we only see that in the minority of patients now. Nobody in our population has an elevated BUN, creatinine, or renal impairment. So we recently looked at people sent to me who had protein in the urine to see what about metabolic control in these patients. And what Jinji Okachuku showed, she's a fellow in pediatric nephrology, she showed that we had 13 people sent to me with protein in the urine, 11 of them had regression or disappearance of the protein in the urine. If you look at the people that improved, their triglycerides fell. It's interesting that no matter what you look at, it always seems to come back to about the same number. In the mid-300s seems to be where complications seem to regress or where the risk starts to increase. There were 2 people in the population who did not have any improvement, but when she looked at those 2 people, they didn't improve their metabolic control. They were still non-compliant, not following the recommendations. And if you don't fix the metabolic control, it doesn't get better. Another common complication is kidney stones. Kidney stones may not be as severe as adenomas or kidney failure, but it was the cause of probably the greatest morbidity that we used to see, because it's very painful and they would be recurrent in the patients. Now, the kidney stones are the only complication in GSD not related to metabolic control. There are several theories out there, but one of them may be it's related to the diet. So the textbooks will say that the kidney stones are due to uric acid, but the textbooks are wrong. We started testing the kidney stones back in 1998, and what we found is that they were always calcium oxalate, not uric acid. So why were people developing calcium stones with GSD? And we did some studies, and what we found is that it was related to citric acid or citrate in the urine. Patients with GSD invariably get very, very, very low levels of citrate in the urine. Maybe it's as simple as the fact that they don't eat fruit, and citric acid normally comes from fruit. But everybody, after they became teenagers, had about one-tenth the normal levels of citrate, and citrate is a normal chelator of calcium in the urine. If you don't have citrate in the urine, you form stones. So we started, back in 1999, supplementing with citrate. We give people potassium citrate using fairly high doses, 20 milliequivalents every given 2 to 3 times a day. We aim for normal levels of citrate in the urine, and when you do that, it prevents the kidney stones. So we went from having 70% of teenagers have kidney stones to having one kidney stone. Actually, this I picked a wrong one. It's now 16 years with one kidney stone. So finally, I'm not going to go through every complication because I hope I've convinced you. But Lori Selenidis, previously Lori Minarich, did a study showing that bone density can be normal. Bone density and osteoporosis are due to poor metabolic control, as you heard from Dr. Cohen, also from low calcium in the diet because they don't drink milk, and low vitamin D. So if we treat with calcium, vitamin D, and get good control, bone density is normal. Now, there is one medical condition that's occurring more frequently as our population's been getting older. Does anybody know what that medical condition is? It's pregnancy. It is a medical condition. And what we have now, as of 3 weeks ago, had our 50th baby born to a mother with GSD. The first baby born to a mother with GSD in the United States was in 2003, and you can see now how fast this is occurring. We have one mother with GSD 1A who has 7 children. We have one mother with GSD 1B who has 6 children. So my only question is, why would anybody want 7 children? But if someone's healthy enough to have 7 children, to be working, to be healthy, it shows you how far GSD has come. Because years ago, people would say that people with GSD couldn't have children. So I just will put up this reference. Iris, you're going to hear from later. She wrote what I think is the landmark article on pregnancy. So if anybody is dealing with a GSD patient with 1A or 1B who has pregnancy, please look up this article. It's very practical. Gives step-by-step guidelines on how to deal with pregnancy in this population. One more comment about pregnancy. Of the 50 pregnancies, 49 have gone to term. We've had only one baby born premature, and that was for conditions unrelated to the GSD, which I think is remarkable, because that's better than we're doing in the United States in the non-GSD population. Dr. Cohen introduced GSD 1B. So GSD 1B has the same sugar problems as 1A, but it also has as you heard, the aforementioned neutropenia and inflammatory bowel disease. The inflammatory bowel disease in GSD 1B is the biggest problem that they have. Now, one of the problems is that it's different than inflammatory bowel disease in the general population. So I'm a pediatrician by training. We didn't see inflammatory bowel disease in very young children. And sometimes you would see it in the teenage years, and it would usually be in the colon. But in GSD 1B, it can present at a very young age. So we have confirmed the diagnosis of inflammatory bowel disease as young as 13 months of age. The disease almost always appears between 5 and 8 years of age. And it's in the small intestine, which is very different. So if people get a colonoscopy and an endoscopy, it can totally miss the disease, which is leading to underdiagnosis of the inflammatory bowel disease. So what we do is we start screening for it at a very young age with inflammatory markers, sedimentation rate, and C-reactive proteins. And what you'll see is as it's developing, the inflammatory markers go very, very high. So it's not uncommon to see SED rates of over 80 or 100, or CRPs in the 40 or 60 range, where normal's 2. We'll also find that their growth is slowing down, and they'll develop anemia because the cytokines that are made from the inflammatory bowel disease cause malabsorption of iron, and they develop a very severe anemia. So if you see growth, stunting of the growth, anemia, high inflammatory markers, think about it. The way that we diagnose this frequently is with a capsule endoscopy, because the regular endoscopy will miss it. And if you can't do that, sometimes we'll just treat empirically, because if we treat and their anemia gets better and their inflammatory markers get better and their symptoms abate, then I know we're treating the right cause. Now, to understand treatment, I want to present one hypothesis. This is not proven, but this is based upon work that we are doing right now, which gives insight into the inflammatory bowel disease in GSD. When people with GSD get treated, they get treated with cornstarch. The cornstarch gets into the intestines and the bacteria start to use it as a fuel. When they ferment the cornstarch, it leads to lactic acid production in the intestines, and the intestines become very acidic. If you've ever seen a baby with GSD who you're starting on cornstarch, sometimes they get horrible, horrible diaper rash, but the diaper rash is from burns because their stools are so acidic. Then what happens is you have people with GSD1B who are getting antibiotics because they're neutropenic. And so you combine the antibiotics with this problem, you get overgrowth of resistant bacteria and pathologic bacteria. And because of the immune problems and the overgrowth of the pathologic bacteria, you get inflammatory bowel disease. That's our theory. We're in the process of proving it, and we have some evidence from the mouse models of GSD1B looking at this. Why is this relevant? Well, what we need to do is treat all of those things. So we treat the immune part of this with G-CSF, Neupogen. We treat with Pentaza. Pentaza is an old-time medication. Pentaza is a non-absorbable salicylate, and it's gone out of fashion in many places. But in the GSD population, Pentaza, or mesalamine, works absolutely great. 90% of our patients never need anything more than this treatment. The dose is much higher than oftentimes is prescribed, so we treat with 50 to 100 milligrams per kilo per day. And while the newer references will say you can do it as a twice-a-day medication, we find that if you give it 3 or 4 times a day, it works much better. So if you use high doses given every 6 hours, it's a great medication in this population. And then we give probiotics. Probiotics may not seem like fancy medications, but if you repopulate the intestines with normal bacteria and you combine it with the other treatments, we pretty much wipe out the inflammatory bowel disease flares. Just one word, if you're ever treating this, don't use steroids, which are commonly used in the general population, because the steroids will cause glycogen breakdown and have been associated with pancreatitis and acidosis. And Iris, I think, has a comment about steroids later. The neutropenia can appear at any point. It can appear at birth, it can appear later on, it can be cyclic, or it can be permanent. If you see a GSD1B patient with neutropenia, you don't need to do a bone marrow study. This is part of the disease, and there was a committee that reviewed it, and hundreds of people have had bone marrow studies, and it has never proven to be useful in anybody. So if you see it, its standard of care now is just to treat the neutropenia. G-CSF has been used since 1989, and it's been life-changing for this population. Instead of dying from complications of infections, the patients are doing well. Now, there was a big mistake, though, with G-CSF. When G-CSF was introduced, it was introduced as 5 micrograms per kilo per day. There were guidelines that came out in 2002 that recommended starting at 5 micrograms per kilo per day and increasing the dose till people got normal ANC counts, normal neutrophil counts. What we realized is that led to significant overtreatment. Patients with GSD1B are much more sensitive to this medication, and the patients who were treated with high-dose Neupogen ended up with complications. So an emergency meeting occurred in 2008 because complications were occurring. People were having ruptures of their spleen, and there were cases of leukemia occurring. And what was found was in Europe, they were using an average of 7.2 micrograms per kilo, and they had a very high rate of side effects. In the United States, we were using 1.8 micrograms per kilo, lower doses, and it was dosed to treat the symptoms and not just the numbers. And we had very few side effects. And it was very clear that there was a relationship between the dose and the complications. So new guidelines came out from both Europe and in North America that recommended starting at 2.5 micrograms per kilo and adjusting only if people are having infections. Don't treat the ANC, the neutrophil count. Treat the patient and use the lowest dose possible. One last thing about GSD1B, a study came out of Italy, and there's actually now two studies that have been convincing that vitamin E supplementation improves neutrophil function and allows even lower doses of Neupogen. That we think this is a benign intervention, so we're treating everybody now with vitamin E. Okay, so GSD3, I just want to say a few words about that. As I mentioned, this is more common along the Pacific coasts of the country. And I have several patients that I've seen from Guadalajara who have type 3. Damien introduced this, so in the interest of time, I'm going to skip an extensive discussion, but just remember the type 3 has muscle and liver involvement. It's the only one that has both. And so the complications are hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, myopathy and muscle weakness. The liver complications can occur, but it's much less common. This is just showing you the liver complications, and only a small percentage of patients develop the adenomas. And with good control, that's preventable. This is including all the people who didn't have good control for many years. The heart and the muscles are the big problems. And the heart disease is due to overstorage of carbohydrate in the heart. So if you eat a lot of carb, it's going to go to the liver, it's going to go to the muscles, it's going to go to the heart. It's going to get trapped in the wall and cause a cardiomyopathy, and it can cause obstruction. It's usually minor, not too clinically significant, but it can get severe. And young children have died from heart attacks because they had outflow tract obstruction. The good news is the heart disease is completely reversible. It's all due to overstorage of carbohydrate, and there's now been 6 articles that have come out that have shown is any treatment that restricts the carbohydrate will normalize the heart. Sorry. One. Sorry about that. So this is from a study that we did. Dr. Aditi Dogley, who works at Orlando now, showed a patient who was sent to us with a very severe cardiomyopathy, so severe that the cardiologist wouldn't even do an exercise test because he was worried that it was too risky. The patient was told to go on a high-protein diet with restriction of carbohydrate. He went on the high protein, but he didn't cut his carbohydrate because for years he had been told to eat carbohydrate and it was just too much change at once. So we came back in, he was 21 years when we saw him. At 22 years of age, his heart was still extremely big. No improvement had occurred. Because he was on high protein, his CK values had come down, but his heart didn't get better. The next year, he was desperate, so he started following our recommendations, and he really cut his carbohydrate, he cut his cornstarch, we went on even higher doses of protein, and when he came back a year later, his heart was entirely normal. This has been seen in numerous patients in our population, and as I said, there are now 6 reports in the literature all showing this. The muscle disease is due to a different cause. So the muscle disease is silent in young people, and that's why it gets missed by the pediatricians. People have no symptoms during infancy, as people, the children start getting more active in childhood, the CK values will increase, and that's due to muscle damage. It's still clinically asymptomatic, so many people are not paying attention to it. If you don't pay attention, what happens by the time they become teenagers, they start complaining of poor stamina, they might start getting muscle cramps, and the natural history of GSD3 was for most patients to end up with severe myopathy by the time they were in their 30s, 20s, 30s, and 40s, and to the point that they were wheelchair bound. So why does this occur? Well, I'm going to summarize what normally is an hour-long talk in just a couple slides here. Normally when people do exercise, they break down glycogen to feed the muscle. So what happens is glycogen breaks down, and when the energy threshold, the anaerobic threshold gets hit, lactic acid starts to form. Lactic acid will cause oxygen release in the muscles, and that allows the muscles to make even more energy. Then that's all from glycogen. When you have GSD3, you don't have access to muscle glycogen. And so the people start to do any kind of activity, their muscles have no fuel. But not only don't they have fuel, but because you don't get buildup of lactate, you don't get oxygen release. So if you look at people with GSD3, they don't increase their oxygen consumption during exercise. And we think that the damage happens because there's a lack of energy and also a lack of oxygen in the muscles that's causing the muscles to get damaged. Well, we've done studies and also the groups in the Netherlands and in Denmark showing that we can treat the muscle disease by giving the muscles alternative fuels. So if we give protein, it can be used as a muscle as a fuel and help protect it. Prior to more intense exercise, we give a little dose of glucose, and that goes in and allows energy to be formed. It also will cause the lactic acid to go up, which causes the oxygen to dissociate in the muscles. And by doing this, we can help prevent the muscle damage. Now, there will be studies coming out in the next year from the International Study for Glycogen Storage Disease. People have said, why aren't the articles published? And that's because we had agreed to be part of an international database and share our data, and I didn't want to take that away from them. So it will be published. The International Study for GSD3 is run out of the Netherlands by Chris Peter Sentner, Terry Dirks, and Peter Smith. But let me give you two stories just to try to convince you that this treatment makes a difference. Well, in 2008, I taught a course in England on glycogen storage disease. And at that course was a doctor from the Faroe Islands who was there because on the Faroe Islands they have a lot of GSD3. And she mentioned that the people were doing very poorly. So she heard us give a talk, she heard me give a talk on high protein and restricting the carbohydrates. She went back to the islands and started making changes, and the patients started getting better. So she invited me to go there in 2009. Now, a little side note, American education is not always very good, and I did not know my geography. So when I was invited in February 2009 to go to the Faroe Islands, I thought I was going to the Caribbean or the Mediterranean or someplace nice, and so I accepted the invitation. I did not know that the Faroe Islands were halfway between Norway and Iceland, and as a Floridian, I really don't like cold weather, so I encourage anybody to study their geography so you don't make this mistake I did. But I went to the islands, and I saw something unique. When the children on the islands were doing very poorly, almost everybody under 18 had large livers, large hearts, and yet the adults were doing well. So this is from my first visit. I'm sorry this doesn't project, but this is a 13-year-old girl, and her liver and heart were so big that she could only walk 50 meters without resting. Meanwhile, this is a 42-year-old lady who wanted me to have a good experience on the island, so she took me up to the top of the mountain so I could see the beautiful islands. Why could a 42-year-old be doing well and the kids be doing very poorly? And the answer was because the young kids had to go to the doctor. On the islands, if you were under 18, by law, you had to go see the doctor. And the doctors were treating GSD3 with maltodextrin and glucose, and they were being fed glucose polymers every 3 to 4 hours. And that was causing storage in the liver and in the heart. Meanwhile, once you turned 18, you could stop going to the doctor. And the natural diet on the Faroe Islands is high protein. Nothing grows there. So they eat fish, they eat whale, they eat sheep, but it's all meat. And this is a typical meal. You have very, very little carbohydrates. So the adults went back to their natural diet and they started feeling better, and clinically they got better. So all the patients stopped being treated with carbohydrate, they went on the high protein diet, and I went back 2 years later and everybody in the group climbed the mountain, and you can see the kids here. The girl who could only walk 50 meters was able to do it, and everybody clinically did well. The kids who were on the liver and the heart transplant list came off it, and nobody ever needed it. I thought that was pretty dramatic, but there's one more situation that's even more dramatic. When I moved to Florida from Boston Children's in 2005, we created a charity so that nobody in the world gets turned away. GSD treatment's affordable, cornstarch. And I didn't want kids to suffer, and yet there were many children out there who were suffering. So we had this charity created, and anybody can come to Florida and get care for free as long as the doctors request it and the family request it. So this is a lady with GSD3 from Wales in the United Kingdom, and she had deteriorated to the point where at 30 years of age, she couldn't walk anymore, she was wheelchair bound, she needed help to use the bathroom, she couldn't eat anymore, everything had to be done for her. And the doctors didn't think it would help, but she was asking to come over on the charity, so the request came in and we accepted her. Now the doctors later confessed they didn't think she would even survive the trip. But she came over, she was being treated with maltodextrin again, which is the standard treatment in many places in Europe. We took her off the glucose and the carbohydrates and put her on protein. And I'm not exaggerating, you can read her story online. The very next day, this lady who hadn't walked in months stood up. A month later, she was running, and she now runs races, and we go running together, and she completely is much better than I am. And it shows the power of protein in this population. So there will be more articles coming out, but I absolutely stand by that the high protein, low carb diet is the way to go. So what we do is we put everybody on 3 to 4 grams per kilo per day of protein. The textbooks will say if the high protein diet causes kidney disease. I can tell you that nobody in the history of GSD3 or any of the other ones treated with protein has ever developed kidney disease. We also have evidence from the Faroe Islands. I mentioned their diet's very high in protein. So because of my relationship with the islands, I have access to the records for everybody on the islands. The normal diet for people without GSD there is 3 grams per kilo per day. And they do not have any higher rate of kidney disease than the general population. So I think the literature out there criticizing high protein diets is flawed. And then what we do is just use as little cornstarch as possible to normalize the glucose and normalize the ketones. We ask people to check their sugars and their ketones at home, and then we adjust the doses to achieve normal values. When we do that, again, all people are normal. Finally, I'll just end with a couple comments on the milder types, the GSD 069. These types of GSD are absolutely underdiagnosed. And just to follow up with the question earlier, GSD0 does exist. I have genetically proven quite a few patients with GSD0. It's interesting, we've never seen someone with 2 stop codons, so maybe you have to have partial enzyme activity to survive, but we do have many cases of GSD0. And the other types, GSD6, which is phosphorylase, and GSD9, phosphorylase kinase, are out there. In fact, a new study that just came out showed that potentially up to 34% of the ketotic hypoglycemia population, if you see a kid with ketotic hypoglycemia, may be glycogen storage disease. And that GSD type 9, the X-linked version, 9 alpha, is probably the most common cause of low sugars in boys, but it's been missed over all these years. So why should we diagnose this condition? I'm just going to skip One reason is to make the liver shrink. So we treat with high protein and low carb, and when you do that, the liver, and we're not storing carbohydrate, the liver shrinks up. And even that's reason enough to treat these patients. But there's other reasons why. If you don't treat it, people typically get hypoglycemic and acidotic during illnesses, and they end up coming into the hospital for IV fluid. It's missed as just gastroenteritis and acidosis, but it's really their GSD. When you treat people with these conditions, they grow better. They've improved stamina. People struggle with sports, and I want everybody to be normal, but if you give them protein and cornstarch, they can do everything. It improves bone density because the chronic ketosis will cause osteoporosis. It improves school performance, and it can prevent complications. So I'm just about done with this section, but I want to end with one more story. This is a story that was highlighted in one of the major papers in the United States. It's the Washington Post. And the Washington Post does medical stories for the whole country. And this is a boy who had two episodes of mild hypoglycemia when he was 2 years of age. He had blood sugars in the 40s and 50s. Doctors just told the family that he had ketotic hypoglycemia and suggested just giving snacks at bedtime. The hypoglycemia was forgotten. As he got older, he went to school, and when he was 7 or 8 years of age, he started to struggle in school. He was struggling particularly at the end of the mornings and in the afternoon, and he got labeled by the teachers as having attention deficit disorder, ADHD. It was because the blood sugars were going down, he would get fidgety because the sugars were low and he couldn't concentrate, but he got labeled as ADHD. I don't know if you have the same problem here, but so many children in the United States get labeled and they get put on medicines. And the medicines are the stimulants, and when the stimulants have a side effect, which is it causes kids to stop eating. They get anorexia. So this child went on stimulants, and then he really got worse. He started having stomach aches every morning, vomiting, which in retrospect was due to the ketones. But the doctors didn't recognize that. And what they concluded was because he was struggling in school with ADHD, that he didn't want to go to school, that this was psychiatric pain in his stomach aches, that he was causing himself to get sick, and they diagnosed him with school avoidance syndrome. They put him on mental health medications thinking that this was all psychiatric, and it didn't get better. And then they went to admit him to a state mental facility because he was struggling so much. He had missed 180 days of school. When he got admitted to the facility, we had a system called Obamacare and with electronic records. And unfortunately, this may be disappearing in the next few years as your wall is being built. But the doctor who was admitting the patient realized that it said ketotic hypoglycemia. And he had heard me give a talk where I said, I don't believe in that diagnosis. So he contacted me, sent me his DNA, and he had GSD type 9. We started him on cornstarch and protein, and this boy who was being labeled as a psychiatric patient in remedial classes has now become an honor student. He has never missed school again, and he's doing great. And so even though these kids were surviving, it's important to make the diagnosis. And finally, with regards to complications, just to show you, these are people with GSD 6 and 9, and they're healthy people. They can do everything. There are a couple comments in the literature about complications occurring. This came out of Canada recently in 2014, and what they realized is that patients with GSD 6 and 9 were developing seizures with alcohol consumption because it blocks the ability of fat and protein to be converted to glucose. They developed adenomas, cirrhosis, and heart disease. Now, this should not occur. I should point out that this population was not treated. So they were eating high carb, and I think that the heart disease was all due to excessive storage of glycogen in the heart, even though there's no heart involvement. And they were chronically ketotic as they weren't being treated, and that's why they developed the cirrhosis. We took a couple people who were diagnosed with cirrhosis, liver biopsy proven cirrhosis, who were on the liver transplant list, and put them on treatment with high protein and cornstarch. And what this article shows, and again it was done by Roy Selenidis, it showed that not only did the laboratory values normalize and the growth normalize, but their liver healed. And so their cirrhosis, because the cirrhosis disappeared because the liver can regenerate. And so all we have to do is normalize the glucose, normalize these ketones, and all these patients should do very, very well. So thank you for paying attention. The take-home message that I want you to have is that all patients with GSD should be healthy. And it's our job to strive for normal labs. And we do that, we'll never need liver transplants. We're not going to see the complications, and people will do well. Thank you.
Sí, adelante. I was asking that since your last visit at the Children's Hospital in Mexico, we have adopted, well, we were already using cornstarch, but we adopted all your recommendations. And we're very surprised because we've seen improvement in our patients, but not to the degree you're showing us. And I have two questions specifically. They've improved greatly because they do not develop hypoglycemia, but metabolic control of lipids, uric acid, is not constant. So I'm wondering, what are we missing? I'm assuming that it is patient adherence. Mexican culture evidently will be different to the culture among your patients, and maybe the lack of adherence might be the answer, despite the fact that we almost put the patients against the wall asking them if they're doing things the way they should. But my question then is, what else can we do when we provide all the recommendations and we do not see metabolic changes? That's the first question. And the second one has to do with renal tubular acidosis. When you were kind enough to visit us, you said that inasmuch as metabolic control improves, so would that acidosis. But we've had controversy with the nephrologist because they insist that acidosis needs to be managed. And they manage the citrates that you mentioned here. I heard that you use nitrous to prevent nephrocalcinosis, but it seems to me that the concept is different. One is to manage nephrocalcinosis, and the other one is to manage the renal tubular acidosis. So I would like to learn your opinion.
So, well, again, thank you for working with us. I enjoyed my visit to Mexico City last year. And I want to continue working together. I think when I look at the population, it takes a while for people to adopt all the recommendations. Cornstarch is easy because that's something you can tell them, it's concrete. I think the hardest part is the diet, because if people are not restricting their fruit, if they're not restricting their dairy, if they're having sugar, absolutely will affect metabolic control. I have many people from Mexico who have come to see me over the years, and I have found that Mexico has a challenge in that many of your foods, like the tortillas, have a lot of carbohydrate. And it's such a big part of the culture, the tortillas, the high-carb foods, that I find that that contributes to the suboptimal control. Because if you give too much, it can be just as bad as too little. And when you give too much carbohydrate, the sugars go high, the body makes insulin and they come down, and then they get low and acidotic. So one possibility is the diet's not as strict as it should be. The second possibility is that there's too much carb. The third possibility is that the equipment that's used may not be giving optimal information. So we have done testing. Actually, Iris has just finished a study showing that most glucose meters are not accurate in GSD. As a result, they're giving falsely reassuring information. What we know from a lot of the companies, like the LifeScan company that makes the one-touch meters and the AccuCheck meters, is that lactic acid interferes with the glucose meter. And this is a known product, although it's not in the packet. And when people get acidotic,
the glucose values read higher. So the AccuCheck meter typically reads about 30 to 40% higher than the normal value. And so patients are checking their sugars, they're getting normal values, they think they're fine, and in reality, they're hypoglycemic and acidotic. The way that we overcome that is we use a meter called the freestyle meter. And then the other thing that we do is we bring people into the hospital and we measure their glucose and lactates around the clock to see if their control's as good as it is. We bring people in once a year and we found that that's the best way to get the doses fixed. Oh, and the second question with regards to the renal tubular acidosis, we find in all of our patients, once they have good control, the renal tubular acidosis completely resolves. We don't start citrate until they're typically teenagers. So we're not masking it with the citrate because they're not on citrate until, you know, they show us they have low citrate. So the renal tubular acidosis is absolutely related to metabolic control. And as we get better metabolic control, I think that will disappear. What? Okay. So I just had a question that came up about protein. I'm just going to move this because the interference. The protein in GSD3 has also been a problem because we know that it's the quality of the protein that's critical. We have many protein products in the United States that don't work in our patients. We use that brand that Dr. Cohen showed because it's a very high quality protein. If we go to one that's oftentimes cheaper or it's being sold for the athletes, it doesn't work as well. And so we have to work and find a high quality protein here in Mexico and also throughout Central and South America because this has been a problem that's affecting metabolic control.
Good morning. Yep. I rather have it in English if the people doesn't, the audience doesn't matter. Thank you for being here. And I'm a GI pediatrician student. I'm very close from Mexico. Actually, I'm from Guatemala. So all the information that you have given us, it's very important for me so I can, now I know more about it. And not only in Mexico can be this disease, and I can research about it in my country as I finish here. And I guess as a pediatrician, this is very important because I guess that you have been following up as they get in an adulthood age. So all your experience is very valuable for us. My question is, with this high protein diet, there is, what about the fiber and the constipation that these patients can have, or they are not developed constipation, bowel constipation, because of the high protein diet? That will be my first question. And the second one, it's about the difference between 1A and 1B. Seeing that the bone marrow is not working well in the 1B, I guess, and I almost assure that you already find out a molecular cause, immunologically relation between IBD and with GSD. I don't know if I make myself clear.
Okay. Well, first of all, thank you for your comments. I appreciate your enthusiasm. Before I address the question, I just want to say that we have 186 adults that we are following in our program. Our oldest patient with GSD1A is now 62 years old, and we are not seeing any complications as people are getting older. The first question about constipation. Constipation is actually common in the GSD population. It's common because cornstarch can actually form plugs it can become like cement in the intestines. So we try to make sure that people get enough fluids to contribute to keep things moving along. We also, as you say, the high protein diet can do that. So we do have people who take fiber. If we have to use a laxative, we use Miralax, which I think is similar used here. But we do have problems and we aggressively treat that. The second question.
Is it chronological? And if you have any findings, molecular findings
Thank you. So GSD1B is due to the glucose 6 phosphate transporter. So 1A is due to glucose 6 phosphatase, which is located on the inside of the endoplasmic reticulum. And for glucose 6 phosphate to get to the enzyme, it has to cross the membrane, which requires a glucose 6 phosphate transporter. In 1B, the transporter is deficient, so it can't get to the enzyme, and that's why they have the hypoglycemia, because they can't convert glucose 6 phosphate to glucose. Now, why does it cause neutropenia? We didn't know that until recently, and there's an article that came out in Blood in last year that showed a pathway in the white cells that we did not understand. So the textbooks say that the neutropenia is due to abnormal formation of the white cells. And our group and also the group in the Netherlands did studies, and what we found is that the bone marrow was entirely normal, and that the bone marrow was producing cells at the correct rate, which meant that the white cells had to be dying. The Netherlands group did a study where they took the white cells and they bathed them in glucose values, concentrations of 450 milligrams per deciliter, very, very high. And if they did that, the cells stayed alive if you gave enough glucose. Some studies that we did with Janice Chu at the NIH showed that there was a pathway in the white cells that we didn't know existed. So what happens is glucose goes into the white cell and it doesn't form glycogen. So it normally has to go somewhere. So what happens is it goes into a loop that we did not know about, where it goes glucose to glucose 6 phosphate, back to glucose, and it forms a basically shuttling back and forth between glucose and glucose 6 phosphate that we can measure and show, and it requires that glucose 6 phosphate transporter for this to occur. When that happens, it preserves glucose in the cell so it's not used, and then when the white cell goes to fight an infection, it can give itself a big energy boost by releasing it. If you don't have that, all glucose gets used up immediately and there's no reserve, and so you get abnormal energy bursts, and so it impairs the immune response. Also, when you don't have this pathway, you get a build, it's too much on the glycolysis in the cell, and it shunts into other pathways, and you get a buildup of some metabolites that cause apoptosis and the white cells to die. So we're actually working on some oral treatments with Janice Chu at the NIH that may inhibit those metabolites from building up so that the cells don't die. And that's one way we're going after it. And we're also working on gene therapy, which we'll talk about later today.
Good afternoon, doctor. Hello, doctor. It has been a privilege to have listened to your presentation. And this week in my hospital, in the hospital where I work, we have seen two cases of GSD type 1A. And certainly, the patients are not as well as your patients at 1 year of being diagnosed. Certainly, there's something we're doing wrong from the nutritional point of view. I have specifically two questions. Your recommended dose for cornstarch is 1.70 grams per kilo, not to exceed 75 grams in children in order to avoid overweight. Could you please confirm? And the other question is, should we avoid fruits and dairy totally, or just limit their intake? And what would be the fruit ratio ration per day? And the other question is, in GSD type 3, how many carbohydrates or how little should be, or how small should be the dose of cornstarch?
Okay, well, Thank you for the questions. The first question with regards to the dose, I want to clarify, we don't use that formula, 1.75 grams per kilo. That's the old formula. There is a formula that I can, that's in our articles, that was worked out based upon the studies by Denny Beer and Maury Haymond. But an average one-year-old needs about 4.5 grams of glucose per hour. And I can sit down with you and give you a spreadsheet that has it, or I can give you the formula so that we use that to calculate it. We do dosing in a baby. We will start at 6 months of age with 1 gram of cornstarch. And what we will do is increase the dose every 3 to 4 days, as long as there's no diarrhea and as long as the patient is tolerating it. You see no benefit initially. So you're not going to see any benefit until you get to about 5 grams. And you, to get to full dosing for a one-year-old, you have to be in about 8 grams. So we slowly work our way up. If you start too fast, they develop diarrhea and they malabsorb. Every time I increase a cornstarch dose, I want to see that the patient goes longer or the blood sugars get better. If we don't see that, that means we are malabsorbing the cornstarch, and I always back off. In a one-year-old, 1 to 2 year old, the most I'll do is every 2 to 3 hours with cornstarch. After 2 years of age, I'll do cornstarch every 3 hours and then try to get to 4 hours at night. By 2 to 3, after 3, we usually can definitely do 4 hours at night, and I will stay on cornstarch every 4 hours until I get to glycosate. I don't go to every 4 hours during the day until the children can reliably eat, because you need to have people who can eat reliably to maintain it for 4 hours. With regards to the fruit and the dairy, we're very strict. You know, we allow up to 2.5 grams, and that came from just a retrospective analysis of where we started seeing biochemical abnormalities. There is a formal study being done in collaboration with Denmark, the group in Copenhagen, to try to prove those numbers. But we do limit it, and we try to tell families to eat as little fruit as possible. I think Magali's going to be talking later, right, about the diet. If you have too much fruit, it's going to cause problems. So we are very strict with that. And we limit in GSD 3, 6, and 9 also the sugars. So the textbooks tell you that you can have as much sugar as you want in 3, 6, 9. But we limit it to typically 5 grams of sugar, because otherwise it's going to get stored and also spike the insulin up. And we also limit the carbohydrates. So even in an older person, we are limiting our meals to 15 to 20 grams of carbohydrate maximum for all the different types of GSD to avoid overstorage of glycogen. Okay.
It has been a pleasure to meet you and to have had the privilege of listening to your excellent talk. And I would like it for you and I to stay in touch via email, or if I could meet with you personally here, because I have some additional comments, because I do not agree with the fact that a deficiency in glucose synthesized may be a disease associated to an overstorage of glycogen, because if there is no glycogen, if there is a hepatomegaly, and this is caused by triglycerides, then this is a disease that is the result of an overstorage of triglycerides. That would be my logical argument. But I would like to check this with you. I published a paper on the deficiency of glucose 6-phosphatase. There I mentioned, or my hypothesis was, that as a compensation, the children with GSD have to somehow decrease the synthesis of glycogen. So the deficiency of glycogen synthase is in the patient with GSD, we don't want them to over accumulate glycogen. So I would have to contact you via email if it is not possible for us to meet here, but it would be very useful for me to stay in touch with you. Thank you.
So actually, I agree with pretty much everything you said. If there's increased glycogen in the liver, it's not GSD0 or glycogen synthase deficiency. So there are true cases of glycogen synthase deficiency, but they have absence of glycogen or almost no glycogen. If it's increased glycogen in the liver, then it has to be GSD1369. It's usually GSD9 in my experience. So most of the people who are labeled GSD0, when they were sent to me, actually had GSD9. And that mistake happens because when the glycogen is full, well, the liver's full of glycogen, and people have a carbohydrate load, the carbohydrate can't get stored, so it shunts down to form lactate. And so they get postprandial high lactates, and they get ketotic hypoglycemia and gets mislabeled as GSD0. So I agree with you on that. And if it's increased glycogen, it's not GSD0, although it is a real disorder. And I would absolutely love to stay in touch. The goal is to have as many collaborations as possible. And I am absolutely committed to having centers of excellence for glycogen storage disease. It's my pleasure to help in any way possible to make sure that the centers get created here. We also want to have a center for gene therapy here in the future. And so that's the reason I'm here, because I envision Guadalajara, Monterey, Mexico City as being natural places for GSD research centers where we can all work together. So that's the goal.